So good to see you here this morning. I ask you to find your seat. We'll get started with our service today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, I didn't have to wait for y'all to settle down that time. Y'all were having to wait for me. It is good to see you today. Isn't it a beautiful day outside? I mean, if you just look outside, not if you're outside, you know. It still is a great day to be at God's house, and we are thankful that you are here. I know there are lots of other places that you could be, but you've chosen to be at God's house, and I trust and pray that God will bless you for it, that our songs that we will sing today will minister to your heart, and that God's word will certainly challenge you and bless you and help you as well. Looking forward to our time together. Let me just remind you that next Sunday is our meal of the month, and so I didn't bring my announcements up here, but that's okay. I just want to remind you of that, and I also want to remind our kids that next Sunday is our Bible Believers verse, and they have a really hard one. It's a lengthy one this time, so I usually don't remind them of it from the podium. I remind them every Wednesday, and then I remind the parents through the text message or email. But remember, kids, it is important that you memorize the scripture and that you're not coaxed through the scripture. We want you to work hard because you've got a tough one. All right, so let's see how many of them will have it ready next week. That's a tough one. I'm thinking they need a double reward next week. What do y'all think? That's good. Anyway, so remember those things and excited about how that God is using His Word, not just for them to memorize it, but to guide their thinking process. God's Word will not return void. That's not my words. Those are His words. And so we can rest assured that when they memorize the scriptures, that God will use it to guide them and to help them. So thankful for that. Well, let's take a moment to go to the Lord in prayer. If you're willing to kneel with me, and if you don't have room or not able, then just stay in your seat or stand, whichever works, but let's pray. Our Father, as we come before your throne today, we want to begin by thanking you. Thanking you for the breath that you have entrusted us with on this yet again another good Lord's Day. Another opportunity for us to come together and to fellowship and to worship and to study your word. We're so thankful for that privilege, for the freedom that we have here to do that, and for those who participate as well. We appreciate the opportunity and those who are involved in our Sunday school hour and the chance for us to dig in and a little more intimate level into your word, and for the chance for us to grow and learn and deepen our understanding of your word, and certainly the time that it helps to prepare us for this morning service as well. Thank you for those that are here today, God, and we know that the world around us is seemingly going south faster and faster. It seems like things are getting worse and worse all around us. And we know that there's a great sense of despair and hopelessness, of doom and gloom and darkness in the world around us. And Lord, everyone needs a ray of hope, a ray of a word of hope, a word of love, and a word of truth. And what a place to be able to come where that we all recognize that we are broken, but we're called to serve one who is perfect and who loves us perfectly. And we have the opportunity to commune together in corporate worship and fellowship. What a privilege that is. And to have that support group. I thank you for each one that makes it up. I pray, God, that you would help us to draw closer to each other because of our time spent here in your house today. I pray more importantly, though, that we would draw closer to you because of the time that we spend focusing on you in our worship and the time that we spend focusing on you in our word. In your word. And I pray, God, that you would just help us to be receptive to that word. Help us to listen, not just with our ears, but certainly and more importantly with our hearts. And God, may you challenge us. May you speak your truth deep into our lives. And may you help us to change and to live in submission and obedience and in accord to your word. May you be exalted in everything that's done and said here today. May it all be for you and your glory. We pray it in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Going to hymn number 541. He keeps me singing. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 5.
There's within my heart.
Never can fail. Heavenly Son.
you're wondering why I'm wearing this non-seasonal shirt today. All the days to be in the 40s, this would be today. Now, we had the opportunity to meet with the Spruels in person in Elia. It's our privilege to give you an update on them. Many of you will know them if you've been here for a while. Carl and Cynthia served as our youth director for several years. It's been, goodness, how long ago was that now? 19 years ago or so. If you go back to that first picture for a minute, Noah, their oldest, was born here. Keola Riley came shortly thereafter. Leilani was born after they moved here. But good friends of mine, as well as friends of many of you, and it was one of the highlights of our trip to go see them, be able to be in church with them, and to get to spend some time with them 3 Sundays ago. So, I want to share a little bit about them. Maybe new to some of you, but for some of you, this will be a little refresher and some addition. So we're glad to be able to share about them, how they're doing well, how the church is doing well, and a little bit about details about their church and some needs they have.
This is the Waipahu Free Will Baptist Church. This is sort of a consolidated version of the two Free Will Baptist churches in Hawaii. Originally, Carl and Cynthia were in Kaneohe, but because of the pandemic and because the church in Waipahu was struggling, they kind of brought everybody together. And so everybody from Kaneohe kind of came and joined Waipahu, so they have one big church there. As you can see, the building looks great. They've done some updates. This is the upstairs, the main sanctuary area.
Cheers.
And cheers.
And cheers.
And this is, his name's John. He is the Sunday school teacher, so he is one of the Hawaii natives. And he did a great job, very friendly. We're now Facebook friends with him. And if you'll see in the bottom there, they actually are using the exact same Sunday school curriculum that we use, so we got that pretty neat. There are a few more pictures of the church if you want to flip through there. This is their stage area. This is Carl in the flesh. He was teaching our main service that morning. He did a great job. And everybody in Hawaii wears aloha shirts to church. Like, that's the thing. Hence why my wife's test is on today. This is their downstairs area. They have sort of like a fellowship hall, and then lining those walls are different Sunday school rooms, children's church, that kind of thing. They have been able to get the funds to get that updated. Everything looks great, and it's really been a big improvement over what they started with, which I don't have pictures of the original, but Carl described it, and it was a little rough to begin with. They've done a great job. This is the nursery room.
This is actually in the basement of what was originally built as the parsonage, and they're actually using this as a classroom / meeting room, and they hope to finish renovating this so that when they have visitors come over, say from home missions, or they have people coming over to do mission trips to help them, they will actually have a room where they can stay. This can be converted. There's a bathroom that they're going to finish, and a kitchen, and some other things that they're going to do. This is just kind of the main room in that basement of the parsonage that they're getting ready to finish. All of these facilities that we're showing you here right now were built under Brother Luther Sanders, which is Carl's grandfather, who actually also lived here for a time when Carl and Cynthia moved here. So many of you know them as well, but this dates back to the 50s and the 60s. Many of the facilities and some of the things that they were updating had been there in large part untouched up until just recently. So lots of upgrades that were needed, but definitely being put to good use, and they're doing a great job with it. What's next? There we go.
I knew that we would be in trouble with both Kathy's if we did not get a picture of this girl. So this is everybody. We've got Noah, Keola, Leilani, and Carl and Cynthia, as well as Noah's girlfriend. So she tagged along with us. But it was really great getting to fellowship with them. Marcus, of course, has a long history with them. They're great friends, and I got to meet them for the first time and get to know them, and it was really a wonderful experience. They're doing really good things in Hawaii, and we were privileged to get to go and see them and hopefully bring back a little bit of support for them.
Yeah. And this was on our trip. Is there one more photo? Yeah.
This is a silly picture, so if you look closely, you can see everybody making a face.
This was after we went to go get Cocoa Puffs, COCO, not the cereal, but COCO Puffs. We highly recommend them. If you're ever in the neighborhood, to go get Cocoa Puffs. They showed us around a little bit, and we got to spend some time with them. Actually got to meet them. couple of things that they specifically mentioned. One is another project that they have kind of next on their list is security system for their place. But you might imagine that would also be in need of attention because they haven't really had much of anything like that. Another is a sound system. What they have is pretty good shape, but that's because one of the leaders on their praise team actually does kind of a DJ business, and he kind of donates the use of that during the week, and we'll set that up and bring it and take it down. So the church itself doesn't have its own equipment to use, so it's something that they can have sort of permanently. And then just being able to continue to meet and reach people. COVID really did a number on their inability to meet with people one-on-one and be able to interact with people. And so a lot of that is still, even now, kind of emerging back to where people are more comfortable talking to one another and being able to relate. And so some of the outfits they're wearing, Waipahu, it's high school, but it's kind of the schools in general, and they can kind of wear that around as supporting the teams and supporting the schools, and it identifies them as being a part of the community because that's where they live, and allows them to be able to interact with one another. So we would encourage you to pray for them, as many of you I know already do, and support them. But we have a great opportunity to come back with personal interaction with being able to see them. And so thanks for letting us share with you this morning.
Thanks for sharing. Yeah, thank you.
Daniel, would you lead us in prayer for this week?
Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for all these people that reached out to us, Lord. They are obedient to you. It's the story of being a testimony of this church itself. We just want to thank you for their commitment to you. And I want to say that you're reaching out to the community. People all over the world need to hear from you. Father, we just pray that you would give them the skills to manage between the work and the teachings, that your hand would be upon them, to guide them, to show them, to move them in the right direction, to provide the funding that it takes, different things that they could use for singing and musical instruments and things of that nature, Father. We know your hand is with them. We know that you're going to support them. Father, we just pray that they would just continue to reach out to these people and revive your church there again, and get this COVID mess behind us, and maybe all be able to sing praises to you all over the land, whether we're here or there in Hawaii or maybe in Pakistan. It doesn't make any difference that we can sing praises to you wherever we are. We pray these things in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's get a stand as we go to number 536. And a hymnal, "In My Heart There Rings a Melody." 536, we sing all three.
I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. It's a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody. In heaven's harmony. In my heart.
We ask that you would bless this offering. Use it for the betterment of your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I had figured you out. I'm
song. What a beautiful message that has. Humbling message as well. Sometimes we think we have it all figured out. We think we have arrived. We're so much better than the world around us, and we need to be reminded that we are so far from there. Amen? And so far from His holiness and His righteousness. And that's why we come to church. Not to make ourselves look good, but to honor Him in His holiness. And to put ourselves in a position to be more like Him. So let's pause again for a quick word. Father, again, we thank You for the time that You have given us. Thank You for this privilege that it is to be at church. Not that we had to come, but that we got to come. And we're thankful for the privilege that it is to worship You. We recognize today that You are holy. And our words fail to convey the reality of how worthy You are of our praise, our adoration, of our complete and total devotion to You. But one of the ways that we can show it is by our worship and by our attention to Your Word and our submission to Your will. I pray, God, that You'd help us to step into that place, put ourselves in surrender to You today and allow Your truth to penetrate our hearts and change our lives. God, help us to be submissive to Your will today. And may You and You alone be exalted in this time. Empower Your Word to change our lives, we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Well, we're looking today again at 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 8 through 10 as we continue forward in our study in 2 Timothy. As you see, I've titled the message today, Not Ashamed. Not Ashamed. I want to begin reading our text and then we will start with our intro to our message. And I think you'll see why the title and why the focus in our message today. So read with me verse 8 through 10. So don't be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord or of me, His prisoner. And by the way, notice that Paul calls himself a prisoner of the Lord, even though he is a prisoner at this time to Roman soldiers. But he identifies as a prisoner to the Lord. Instead, share in suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God. He has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. In other words, God purposed this. This was not plan B. Sometimes when we read about the resurrection story and we read about the death and the suffering of Jesus, we think that man forced this upon Jesus and man forced this upon us. We need to be reminded of the fact this was God's purpose and plan all along. Way before Jesus physically set foot on the earth, this was God's plan. Man didn't conquer. Man didn't force his way and his will. God willed this before it ever began. And this is a reminder of that. God knew and purposed this long before. And verse 10 says, "This has now been made evident through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus." He fulfilled God's purpose and plan that He purposed long before. Who has abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. So, the title this morning, Not Ashamed. And let me begin by first of all telling you that I received a revelation this past week that I need to honor. And not a revelation from God, so be careful of that. But many of you have seen the movie War Room, right? If you've seen that movie, you can identify. All right. So you know the character of the prayer warrior Clara in there? In one portion in the movie, she makes this statement, and I was directed by my loving, insightful daughter over there that this should be my statement before every message. And after I tell you this, you'll see why she said that. She said in the movie, which we watched this past weekend, "Don't let me push too hard, Lord. I know I've got a big mouth." And so I'll be careful not to push too hard, even though I've got a big mouth. So the title again is Not Ashamed. A lot has been said lately about shame. Some around us want you to be ashamed of your skin color, if you're not a minority. Some want you to be ashamed of your gender. Change it to whatever you want it to be. Just don't be proud of who you were created to be. Some want you to be ashamed of your family and let them, that is, those around us, destroy it and redefine it and reassign it. Some want you to be ashamed of your nationality, especially if you're not American. Let's just all be one united body and then let the UN take charge and direct us. Some want you to be ashamed of your church's denomination. Been a huge push in recent years of separation from identity of denominations. Let's just be a non-denominational church. No doctrinal persuasions. Some want us to be ashamed of our religion. You can't say that Jesus is the only way anymore. Let's be all-inclusive. And let me begin today by telling you that I'm not ashamed of any of the aforementioned items, and don't apologize for any of them either. Yeah. I also don't need some woke lunatic trying to fix these things for me, and neither do you. Our text tells us to not be ashamed of our faith or of our Lord.
Right.
So I want to ask you right off the bat this morning, are you ashamed of the gospel? Are you ashamed of Jesus? What if push comes to shove, and it very well may soon, are you willing to suffer persecution? Are you willing to suffer your job? Are you willing to suffer your retirement? Are you willing to suffer the loss of your friends? Are you willing to suffer the loss of your position? Are you willing to suffer the loss of your family members? Are you willing to suffer the loss of your health for what you believe in? We don't think much about that in our world today, do we? Not in our comfortable America. A.W. Tozer wrote that little by little, evangelical Christians these days are being brainwashed. One evidence is that increasing numbers of them are becoming ashamed to be found unequivocally on the side of truth. They say they believe, but their beliefs have been so diluted as to be impossible of clear definition. That's an alarming awareness of our culture and our world today, isn't it? Samuel Johnson wrote that shame arises from the fear of men and conscience from the fear of God. Which are you more likely to follow? When Paul wrote the letter that we are studying in 2 Timothy, Paul and many of the Christians around him were facing widespread persecution. They were mocked, they were being imprisoned, and many of them even being killed for their beliefs. And so when Paul penned these words, "Don't be ashamed of the gospel or of me, a prisoner of Christ," those words really resonated with those people. Because on an everyday basis, they had to weigh whether they were going to go out and be bold in their faith and unashamed of who they were in Christ and potentially suffer great loss or just kind of keep it under wraps. Not be so vocal. Not be so clear. Not be so outspoken. Yes, love Jesus, but don't have to tell everybody about it. And that was the struggle that they faced. And we so do not identify with that in the sense of most Christians in America today. In Mark chapter 8, verse 38, we read, "For if anyone is ashamed of me," who's speaking those words? Jesus. If you have a red letter edition of the Bible, those words are in red letters. And he says, "For if anyone is ashamed of me and my words," this, the Word of God, the Bible. "If anyone's ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will also be ashamed of him when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." That's an alarming reality that many will face because of their shame for being a follower of Jesus. Then Jesus will in turn be shameful of them as well. I don't know about you, but that alarms me. That scares me. That troubles me. Can I just be honest? That's unsettling. The thought of my Lord and Savior, the one who died on the cruel cross of Calvary for my sins, that he would be ashamed of me simply because I was ashamed of him. You see, to truly follow Christ, we must not be ashamed of him and his teachings. In Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew and also to the Greek." Where's that power come from? From the Word of God. Don't be ashamed of it. There are, it seems, more opportunities and more Bibles and more available readings of Scripture today than any time before, and yet it seems you never see people with the Word of God. I'm thankful that we have the electronic devices that allow us to put the verses up here for us to read. I'm thankful that we now have Bibles in our pews. I'm thankful that we have Bibles on our phones, because I use mine often. But the truth is, I'm afraid that we're becoming a people that rarely ever take our Bible literally anywhere we go. And I'm afraid that that has led to many who are ashamed of God's Word. Used to, if you carried your Bible, it was obvious. Right? And now people feel like, well, I mean, I don't carry my Bible anywhere I go. I've got it on my phone. And no one has to know. You see? And our text is a great warning about being ashamed of God, of His Word, and those who are His followers. So, not ashamed is the challenge that I want to give in our message today and in the text that Paul gives us. Our first point is, we are called to be empowered by God. We are called to be empowered by God. In other words, not to be some weak, sissy Christian that's apologetic about everything that God says and everything that our culture attacks in the Word of God. It seems like everyone, and by the way, I'm not saying that we should be apologetic about apologetics. Now, those are two different words. Apologetic means that I am apologizing for something, and the word apologetics has become a theme of a concentration of study in Scripture and in philosophy and thinking, if you will, so that God's people formulate such a concise Christian biblical worldview that we are able to give an answer for what we believe and why we believe it. And so that when we are dealing with the lost, we're able to respond to their questions and hopefully shed the light of God's Word in a way that will draw them to Jesus. But that's different than feeling like we owe an apology because we don't believe in the woke mentality that the world is trying to shove down our throat.
Right.
And that's where I feel that far too many Christians today are. So we're called to be empowered by the Word, and we're called to be empowered by God. Again, not soft, not sissy, not weak, and not like a dog with our tail tucked between our tails and running from every situation. 2 Timothy 1:8, our text again says, "Do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord." Do not be ashamed. But what does he start with? What's that first two-letter word? So. So. The word so takes us back to one of our focuses in verse 7. Remember, we built a whole message out of just one verse. Scared y'all to death when I said we have one verse today. And what did we see in that verse? Remember? He says, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but one of what? Power and love and a sound mind." And we talked about that power and where that power comes from and what God desires for everyone who is called a child of God, a born-again believer. God wants you to walk in His power. And so in verse 8, it's connecting us right back to verse 7 when Paul explained what God doesn't want us to do or who He doesn't want us to be, and then describes who He does want us to be. And now he's telling us, because of that, we have reason to walk out there and not be ashamed. The Spirit of God gives us the power to be bold, to love those who persecute us. And the Spirit of God and the Word of God guides us with godly discipline to live our lives. The reality is, when we are not living a disciplined, godly life, and we are not bold in our faith, it is in those moments that it is clear evidence that we're not walking in the power of God. Amen? Are you with me, church? Because if we were walking in the power of God, the Spirit of God enables us to be bold and not fearful, and the Spirit of God enables us to live a disciplined life. You see, we wrestle with those choices every day and in every issue, in every moment we struggle whether we're going to submit to the Lord and walk in the Spirit or walk in the flesh. What does it mean to walk in the Spirit? It means to be submissive to the Spirit of God and choosing to do that which honors Him. It's not just that I recognize the list of do's and don'ts in the Bible, and since I'm a Christian, I should not do these things and I should do these things. And that's what I think so many Christians think the Christian life is. But it's not a list of do's and don'ts. It's a list of who I am and whose I am. And because I am His and I am a child of God, the Spirit of God indwells me and He empowers me. He equips me. He enables me and He guides me to do that which I should do. It's not just, "I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. If it kills me, I'm going to do it." No. It's He is going to do it in me and through me. He's going to equip me and enable me to do it. Amen?
Amen?
You say, "I am so weak. I'm too weak. I can't do it." Exactly. That's what He wants you to understand. You are weak. And you can't do it. You will fail when you walk in your own power and in your own strength. It is when you and I as believers rely on the Spirit of God that we are powerful, we are bold, we are victorious, and we do that which is right and honors God.
Yeah.
And only then do we do it.
Yeah.
So what does it mean to walk in the Spirit of God? I want you to think about this. And I penned some things I want to share with you in regards to the Spirit of God. This, and these are in order, so you can just go ahead and populate them kind of quick, if you will, Abby. It's the same Spirit that filled Christ Jesus during His earthly ministry. Isn't that encouraging? It's not some weakened, watered-down, diluted Spirit that we get a fraction of that Jesus had when He was here. No, it's the same Spirit. Do you get that? The same Spirit of God that indwelt Jesus when He walked on the earth is the same Spirit that wants to fill you and empower you as well. Isn't that good?
Yes.
I mean, that ought to just light our fire. Oh, I'm just getting started. It's the same Spirit that enabled Jesus to resist the devil's temptations. You remember that? And we read about those temptations when the devil took Jesus and tempted Him, and Jesus was faithful, and He did not give in, and He resisted the enemy, and He used God's Word. It's that same Spirit that equipped and empowered Him that can and will equip and empower you. It's the same Spirit that enabled Jesus to suffer persecution and die on the cross. You know what some people say? Man, I could never do that. I could never put up with, I could never endure such intense persecution. Oh, you could if you were being led and empowered by the Spirit of God, because the same Spirit that empowered Jesus to endure His persecution can empower you too. You never were intended to handle it on your own, because you can't and you would fail, but the Spirit of God can and will empower you. It is the same Spirit that empowered the apostles to faithfully spread the gospel and to build the New Testament church. That's the same Spirit that wants to guide and empower you. You say, well, I just don't think I've got enough courage to speak to my neighbor. I don't think I can speak to my nephew or my child or my husband or my wife. I can't speak to that person in the grocery store line. I just don't have enough. I'm just not outgoing enough. I just can't get enough courage. The Spirit of God can empower you, the same Spirit that enabled those wimpy apostles that were hiding in the upper room after Jesus was arrested and crucified, and they were ready to go back to the old life that they were living before Jesus, and the Spirit of God got a hold of them and you couldn't shut them up. Amen? And that same Spirit can get in you too. And it's the same Spirit that we read about in Acts chapter 4, verse 31. Let me share that verse with you. Acts 4:31 says, when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak the Word of God courageously. You see, that same Spirit wants to fill and empower you too. So you see, when we are soft and when we are wimpy and when we are fearful and we don't have the courage, it's not God's fault, it's our fault, because we're not allowing the Spirit of God to empower us and to guide us. Amen? And it's the same Spirit, finally, that empowered Stephen in Acts chapter 7. You remember reading of Stephen's death? In Acts chapter 7, Stephen boldly preached the gospel of Jesus Christ and then declared, are you ready for this? In Acts chapter 7, verse 51, listen to this. He said, you stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts and ears, you are always resisting the Holy Spirit as your ancestors did. You do also. Wow, he was asking for it, wasn't he? And guess what? He got it. But you know what? He was boldly preaching the Word of God. He wasn't over there saying, I'm sorry that God's Word offends you. I'm sorry that you don't like that God made male and female. I'm sorry that God created life and you don't like that idea and that we defend life. You see what I'm saying? We could go on and on. He wasn't saying those things. He was boldly declaring the Word of God, and it offended people. And they stoned him to death for it. But it's the same Spirit that empowered him in the closing moments of his life when he cried out to God to not hold this sin against them, or in other words, to forgive them. How could Stephen do such a thing in such an agonizing moment after he suffered martyrdom for the cause of Christ? Because the Spirit of God empowered him to do it. And that same Spirit will empower you too, and will enable you to do what God's calling you to do if you'll let it. Since we, you and I, have the same Spirit, not some diluted form and fashion, but the same Spirit of God as these that I have just given record of, we must not give up. And that's what Paul is pleading in his text. We must not quit. We must not allow the world around us to silence us. The Spirit of God is our power, not who we are and who we've made ourselves to be.
Yeah.
Warren Wiersbe tells the story of an imprisoned Christian about to be burned at the stake. And he was afraid that he could not endure the suffering and that he would deny Christ because of it. And Wiersbe shares that one night he experimented with pain by putting his little finger into the candle flame. And it hurt, and he immediately withdrew his finger and he cried out, "I will disgrace my Lord. I cannot bear the pain." But when the hour did come for him to die for his faith, he praised God and gave a noble witness of Jesus Christ, as Wiersbe says, and God gave him the power when he needed it, but not before. Amen?
Yeah.
Why? Because the Spirit of God will enable you for what you need to endure. If you're not ashamed. Be not ashamed, Paul said. Be not ashamed. Are you allowing the Spirit of God, this same Spirit, to empower you to stand firm in the face of a lost and broken world? Are you silent and apologetic for the bold truths that goes against the culture and this woke, crazy, messed up mentality that they're trying to shove down our throats?
Right.
Number two, we are called to suffer for the gospel. We are called to suffer for the gospel. We talked about some of that in our Sunday school lesson this morning as well. It's not a very popular idea. It's not a comfortable thought. As I said in my Sunday school class this morning, most of us do any and everything possible to avoid any kind of suffering. Amen? But our text tells us that we are called to suffer. Look at what he said. He said, share in verse 8 in the suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, suffering is the badge of a true Christian. Wow. Just think about that for a moment. Suffering is the badge of the true Christian. And most of us would just say, well, I'm glad I ain't got to suffer. And we'll do anything and everything we can to avoid suffering. But suffering identifies us with faithfulness and devotion and true commitment to Jesus, His name, and His truth. Jesus suffered, and He said those who followed Him would suffer. We must ask ourselves, if we're not suffering, then why not? It's not that the world is falling footstep in line with Jesus and His teachings, right? It's not that they are in total submission and surrender. Let's do it His way. No, not at all. So if we're never suffering in our world, even in America today, not that necessarily we need to be in prison, but if we're not suffering, we must ask ourselves, why not? D.A. Carson said, there's a certain kind of maturity that can be attained only through the discipline of suffering. In other words, there's just some things that you learn and some development and growth that happens, some sense of spiritual maturation that only comes when we suffer. Some would say, well, I'd rather not grow that much. Just keep me like a baby and give me the milk, please. Spurgeon said, do not kick against suffering, for in so doing you may be fighting against God. Life without struggle and difficulty is thin and tasteless. How can a noble life be constructed if there be no difficulty to overcome, no suffering to bear? Those are some really insightful, eye-opening statements about suffering for Jesus. So letter A, we should accept suffering from the Lord. We should accept it. Instead of resisting it, instead of fighting it, instead of running from it, hiding from it, resisting it in every way possible, we should accept it. Maybe even embrace it. Amen? This means that our sufferings are not random, but that they are purposeful, and we realize that. They are coming from the gracious hand of God. Do you know, by the way, in any moment what you are facing, do you know whether it's coming from the enemy or from God? Most of us don't. But what we can do is see it in that God is overall, God is sovereign. And whether it comes directly from the enemy or directly from God, God allowed it.
Yeah.
It's not an accident. And so we should see God's hand in it and realize that God is trying to do something in our life. God's trying to build us up, even in that suffering. Notice that Paul does not, and I pointed this out earlier, does not call himself a prisoner of Rome, but a prisoner for Christ's sake. Paul saw his imprisonment as under God's control, not under Rome's control. Isn't that good? And what we choose to do is we choose to focus on those who are persecuting us or those who are afflicting us in any way, and we wrestle or we fight and we resist them. You remember the Bible says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. And Paul realized that. He didn't just make that neat little theological statement. He thought that and he lived that. You see, he recognized that Rome could do nothing to him apart from God's permission. And neither can your boss, or your spouse, or your child, or your neighbor, or your enemy, whomever it may be, apart from God's permission. He saw suffering as part of God's plan. In Philippians 1:29 it says, "For it has been granted to you not only to believe in Christ, but also to suffer for Him." So instead of fighting suffering, we might ought to change our perception about it and embrace it and accept suffering from the Lord. It makes us depend on God and grow in our faith. Isn't that true? Whereas if life were easy and there never were any suffering, would we really ever feel like we needed God and His strength and His help? Would we really be strong in the Lord if we never had to depend on Him? We would be so weak, so fragile. Let it be. We should remember that others are suffering as well for the cause of Christ. In other words, you're not alone. Now, it's not that you should ever wish that someone else is suffering whenever you're going through something, but isn't it at least a little bit comforting to know that you're not walking that all by yourself, that you're not the only one that's ever experienced that, that you're not the only one that's ever felt this way? Paul challenges Timothy here. Listen, he says, share in the suffering for the gospel. So in other words, he says, participate in it, accept it. Share in it. In other words, you're not alone. You're going through it with us. We're going through it with you. You're not facing this all by yourself. You see, Paul's mention of his suffering was meant to encourage Timothy to willingly accept his suffering. In other words, Paul was saying, hey, Timothy, guess what? I know you're going through some suffering, but look, this is some of the suffering I'm going through. Not to say to Timothy, hey, forget what you're going through. Look at mine. Mine's worse. But to say, look, I'm going through some suffering too. You're not alone. And sometimes we need to be reminded of that reality. It's true for us Our sufferings are not unique to us. They're experienced by other Christians throughout the world. Many times, far greater is their suffering than ours could ever be. In 1 Corinthians 10:13, it says, "No trial has overtaken you that has not or is not faced by others. And that God is faithful that He will not let you be tried beyond what you're able to bear, but with the trial provide a way out that you may be able to endure it." Isn't that encouraging to know?
Yeah.
That God's not going to let you alone, that God will help you, but you're not going through this all by yourself, that others are and have and will face those struggles as well. Letter C, we should suffer for the gospel. We should suffer for the gospel. We like to think that all of our suffering is for our faith, but in truth, a lot of our suffering is just because of our own stupidity. Amen? In other words, if I'm driving down the road doing 70 miles an hour and I get a ticket, that mean old police officer is persecuting me. No, it's probably not because of the "I love Jesus" sticker on the back of your car that you got a ticket. It's because of your crazy driving you got a ticket. Amen? If you got mad and kicked the door, I've never done this before, because you had a flat tire and left a dent in your door, then you're not being persecuted because of your faith. You got a dent in the door because you can't control your own temper. It's your own stupidity that's brought this upon you. Amen? And I could give you many other stories. I'm sure you could share some as well. So make sure when we talk about our suffering that we're talking about suffering for the gospel. Not because, "Oh, my poor little toe," you know. It's not because of our stubbornness. It's not because we are outspoken. It's not because we're annoying or because we are a bully. Those are not the kind of sufferings that we're talking about. We're talking about suffering for the sake of the gospel. Or because of the truth of God's Word. We should always be willing to embrace that kind of suffering. Charles Hodge wrote, and this is a lengthy quote, and I have it for you, so Abby's going to populate it for you. You can read along with me in case I get lost. "The gospel is God's message of mercy to humanity. It contains an exhibition of the plan, and the only plan, of salvation. It sets forth the person, the work, and the offices of Christ, and urges all to whom it comes to accept Christ as their God and Savior, and to devote themselves to His worship and service. And it assures those who do so that they shall never perish, but shall have eternal life. In one sense, it is everyone's duty, provided he or she has received the knowledge of the gospel." Listen to this. Let me restate that line. "In one sense, it is everyone's duty, provided he or she has received the knowledge of the gospel, to preach it, to make it known to others. The commission and command, 'Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature,' in Mark 16:15. Is given not to the apostles exclusively, but to the whole church and all its members." Can you raise your hand with me and say, "I am they"? All right? That's who the commission is intended for. All of us. He says every member has the right and the obligation to make known this great salvation to his fellow humans. Now let me pause and ask you a very personal question. Please don't respond. Don't raise your hand. Don't say, "Hey, you need to know. This is for you. This is for you." Okay? Are you ashamed of the gospel? And I know most of us would quickly say, "No, I'm not ashamed of the gospel at all." Now, I'm going to get personal for a moment. Please don't answer, but when's the last time you shared the gospel with someone? When's the last time you intentionally took time to share with them their need for salvation? Now, listen. Posting stuff on social media is good, and that's a tool. And that is a way to do it. But when's the last time you personally took the Word of God and said, hey, I'm concerned about your soul? Do you know that Jesus died on the cross so that you could have eternal life? Have you ever put your trust in Him? You say, well, I just don't have enough information. I'm not outgoing. Or are you ashamed of the gospel? You see, the commission was given to every one of us, not just to the pastors and the missionaries. You, too, are to share the gospel. If you're not ashamed of it, then you will find opportunities to share the gospel. You say, you're distorting, you're twisting, you're trying to make us feel... No, I'm not. I'm just trying to make application to the truth that we hear. It's one thing to hear all these lofty ideas, it's another to put it in practice, isn't it?
Yeah.
And if we're not ashamed of the gospel, we're going to tell other people about the gospel. Amen?
Amen?
Because we want them to know what we know. If you knew a simple cure for cancer and you knew someone, even if they were not one of your loved ones that had cancer, you would want them to know. I would bet you would do anything to go share that simple cure with them. You wouldn't be ashamed of it, even though you didn't come up with it, just by the fact you knew it, you'd want them to know it. If we're not ashamed of the gospel, we're going to share the gospel with other people. A.B. Simpson said that the gospel tells rebellious men that God is reconciled, that justice is satisfied, that sin has been atoned for, that the judgment of the guilty may be revoked, the condemnation of the sinner canceled, the curse of the law blotted out, the gates of hell closed, the portals of heaven opened wide, the power of sin subdued, the guilty conscience healed, the broken heart comforted, the sorrow and misery of the fall undone. Man, that's good, isn't it? Doesn't that just make you want to shout the gospel on the mountaintop? Maybe we just don't realize the power of the gospel. And that is the truth that all lost men need. Can I just put your mind at ease and help you to understand that they don't need you. And they don't need me. What they need is the gospel. And we are simply agents to deliver what they need. They need the gospel. And we're obviously not going to get to point number three today. So let me kind of wrap this up by this. I want to ask you, have you ever been rejected by one of your friends or your family members because you took a stand in your faith or for the gospel? Have you ever been criticized and mocked? Maybe even lost a friend or a family member reject you over that? Have you ever been overlooked from a promotion? Lost a job or some possessions because of your faith and your devotion and commitment to Jesus? You say, most of us would say, well, maybe a little bit on the front end, but not anything serious. Most of us haven't suffered great loss or great persecution for our faith yet. Would you be willing if the time came? And then the question sometimes really is, maybe is part of the reason we haven't been suffering for Jesus, maybe because we haven't been standing for Jesus. Open doors, I've referred to them on numerous occasions, and they're a really great tool to open your eyes to see the persecution in the world around us. Open Doors Ministry. They reported in 2021 that 340 million Christians suffer high levels of persecution for their faith, even for simply reading the Bible. Their study said, on average, every day in 2021, 13 Christians worldwide were killed because of their faith. Every day, 12 churches or Christian buildings were attacked in 2021. And every day, 12 Christians were unjustly arrested, detained, or imprisoned. And every day, 5 Christians were abducted for faith-related reasons. Now, those are startling numbers in our world today. We like to think that the persecution that Paul related to and talked about was 2,000 years ago. None of that happens today. Oh, but it does.
Yeah.
And you see, we are so used to our comfort and our isolation and our ability to detach from those around us that we face little persecution probably because we don't oppose the world around us. Probably because we don't offer much resistance to what's going on in the world around us. Probably because we're not speaking out the truth that would invite, if I can use that word loosely, such persecution and opposition to us. Because we'd rather just keep a low profile and not have any resistance whatsoever. It's an alarming reality, isn't it? What about you? Are you ashamed of the gospel? Now, I'm not saying, are you bold and brave enough to stand in here and say, I love Jesus? That's good. That's a start. Some would even do that. But are you so unashamed of the gospel that you'd be willing to share it with someone else? That's where we need to be.
Yeah.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for loving us in spite of our weaknesses, in spite of our failures, in spite of our commitment and dedication to ourselves and our comforts, our desires, and the acceptance of those that we love. When in truth, Lord, we should be completely and totally committed and dedicated to you. For none of those that we love, even though they may be very close family, they may be our own blood, none of them have died for us. None of them have suffered as you have, and none of them offer us eternal life that only you give. Father, I pray that you would open our eyes to the urgency of the broken world around us. And help us to see, God, that the world doesn't need Christians just to be committed to Christianity at church and in their homes behind the closed doors. Listen to their Christian music in their cars and just faithfully follow Jesus without ever encountering the world around them. That our world that is broken and those that are our neighbors and even our family members are headed to hell without you. God, I pray that you would breathe the breath of the Spirit of God into us with such boldness and fervency that the world would not be able to shut us up. That instead of offering apologies for what thus saith the Word of God, we boldly yet lovingly proclaim, thus saith the Word of God. Because it is your truth that the world needs. And not our efforts to water it down. God, have your will in our hearts. Maybe today you've spoken through the Spirit of God into the hearts of some in this church, and they would recognize that they need greater boldness. I pray, Lord, that you would continue that work and that they would, in obedience to you, pray and invite you to give them that boldness as they confess their failures and their weaknesses, their sin of disobedience. God, that you would restore them and breathe new life into their lives. And God, that they would leave here, that we would leave here today with a renewed sense of commitment and dedication to you and to your word, of being unashamed of the gospel, unashamed of Jesus Christ, and looking for opportunities to share that truth with those around us. May you do that work in our hearts, God, that only you can do in these closing moments, we pray now in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand, please? Marcus leads us in a song of invitation. With your heads bowed, would you sing along or pray or come forward and kneel and pray and just let the Spirit of God lead you.
Amen.